Jimmy was an excellent player. He was an excellent goal scorer. He had a lot more skill than people gave him credit for. He had a lot of good passing ability. But, of course, the most important thing was his ability to get the ball in the net. And I've tried several times since then, even while talking to people like Ardiles, to say, look, you get into these positions and yet you can't score. When Jimmy Greaves got into these positions, he didn't try to blast the back of the net out. He seemed to place the ball just inside the post as if he's making a pass to the stanchion in the back of the net.
A volley for Spurs. Greaves. Beautiful play. Robbed by Perriman, and Greaves has got the whole field. He's got the whole field to himself. He'll have to beat the defender. He's got the goalkeeper now.
Spurs reached the semi-final of the European Cup in 1962 and met Benfica, the holders. A 3-1 defeat in the first leg in Lisbon left Tottenham with little option.
I said to the lads, look, the one thing we've got to do is to give everything we've got. Because if we lose through playing, you know, a sort of controlled game, so many people are going to say, they can do better than that, they're bloody fitter than that, and they can get involved more. So if we're going to go down, let's go down fighting.
And so they did, on an unforgettable night when North London shook to the strains of glory, glory, hallelujah. Even when Benfica scored first to go 4-1 ahead in the tie, Tottenham stormed back with a typical goal by Smith. But Blanchflower's penalty left them one goal short of survival.
Particularly were we disappointed because we would have had a crack at Real Madrid in the final, and I felt that we could have beat Real Madrid in that final.
Instead, Spurs reached the FA Cup final at Wembley for the second year running. This time, their opponents were Burnley, and the man who made it his business to score in his first match of any type, number 10 Jimmy Greaves, took just 3 minutes to pierce their defence. Burnley managed to equalise, but not to contain a rampant Tottenham. It was John White, the ghost they called him, who laid on the second goal for Smith. And later, Blanchflower stroked in a penalty to keep Spurs' hold on the cup. It was a passport back into Europe, into the Cup Winners' Cup this time. There were more dramatic floodlight matches in London N17. But nothing as satisfying for Spurs as the final in Rotterdam in May 1963. This became known as Dyson's match. His extraordinary goal put Spurs 3-1 in front just when Atletico Madrid had fought their way back. And in the absence of the injured Mackay, Dyson drove Spurs to a 5-1 victory.
This is Dyson. Smith moving up on the right wing. He's cutting in. He's calling for the ball. But Dyson's got another. He's got another with 3 minutes to go.
But Spurs' greatest team lasted only 3 years. The trophies they carried exultantly down the Tottenham High Road were won by a side dependent on three exceptional players. And within a year, Nicholson lost them all. Danny Blanchflower, 38 and plagued by knee trouble. Dave Mackay, who twice broke a leg. And most tragic of all, John White, struck dead by lightning while he sheltered under a tree on a golf course. Mackay recovered to captain Spurs to the FA Cup in 1967. The team now included Jennings, England and Gilzean. But it was a 15-year-old schoolboy in the crowd, about to sign apprentice forms, who would be the next Tottenham captain to receive the FA Cup.
I joined in the summer of 67, I think it was. And I'd been at the club for about 3 or 4 days when I was asked to take part in a television programme, a kids programme, explaining the life of an apprentice professional. And I'd only been at it 3 or 4 days. And the opening shot was me surrounded by Gilly Greaves, Dave Mackay, Mike England, Pat Jennings, Cyril Knowles. And it was an unbelievable experience. And something I couldn't quite live down, because there was other apprentices had been there for 2 or 3 years and they deserved to be on the programme, but I was put up obviously because I'd just left school and I'd played for England schoolboys.
Spurs reached four cup finals in Perryman's first 4 years as a regular. The UEFA Cup was clinched against Wolves in 1972 by the powerful Martin Chivers. But this and two League Cups still left Nicholson the perfectionist short of the swaggering standards he'd set. He resigned in 1974 and Terry Neill had 2 years as Spurs manager. But it was Keith Birkinshaw who had to shoulder the burden of relegation in 1977 after selling Pat Jennings. But the new manager was made of strong stuff. Promotion after just 1 year was celebrated by Spurs on Southampton's ground, but it was consolidated in Buenos Aires. There, Birkinshaw clinched the signing of Ricky Villa and Argentina's midfield player Osvaldo Ardiles, players in keeping with the purest tradition of Tottenham Hotspur.
3 minutes to go, Villa for Spurs, no score of the match so far. Number seven, Ardiles, it's there! The Argentinian has done it!
The first thing, I liked them as footballers, and our dealers at the time, of course, had been on television a lot, and he'd excited everybody's imagination in England, and just to have the chance to go out there and talk to him, whether I got him or not, was a thrill in itself. But to pull off the deal where I got both of them back in England, well, really, I couldn't believe my luck at the time.
And Spurs' own finest modern product was now approaching his prime.
There's Huddle! Oh, smash it! Oh, that's a brilliant goal!
The signing in 1980 of Steve Archibald and Garth Crooks gave Spurs the thrust they'd lacked since the days of Greaves and Gilzean. With these two responding to Hoddle's prompting, Spurs were on their way to Wembley.
Crooks is going through here. Oh, he's outpaced them! Crooks is there! Oh, yes! Number two for Crooks, number two for Tottenham, and a magnificent ball by Glenn Hoddle.
Here's Villa. Villa's shot!
That semi-final victory over Wolves, opponents who seem to have punctuated Tottenham's history, took Spurs into the 100th FA Cup final. Their opponents, Manchester City.
Here's Ranson. Oh, what a flying header and a brilliant goal! Tommy Hutchison on the ground. And that was Hoddle. Oh, yeah! Off Hutchison, it's in! Tommy Hutchison has scored at both ends, if you call it an own goal.
But sadder even than Hutchison was the substituted Ricky Villa.
I feel very depressed, really, because when you're off the pitch, you know, can't play, you know, and this is terrible for any player. And I believe my chance to win the FA Cup is gone, you know, and really, I want to cry.
Brilliant. And his Archibald has got a chance. Good save, Ricky Villa! Ricky Villa scored! Ranson with the kick. Miller. Reeves underneath it, and now Hutchison to McKenzie! Oh, tremendous goal! Steve McKenzie! On by Reeves to Bennett. Paul Miller trying to check Bennett. Down goes Bennett. Penalty! Penalty! And here comes Reeves, and it's there! Oh, the chance here for Archibald! Crooks! Villa. And still Ricky Villa! What a fantastic run! He scored!
I remember I get the ball, you know, I feel confident in this game. I don't know why. I believe I can win the game. When I get the ball, I say, going for a goal. And pass, and I have to pass other one, and in the end shoot, and the ball is in the net. It was perfect, you know. Very pleased.
For the two South Americans, winning the FA Cup was an ambition in itself. But for Spurs as a club, it marked the return to the forefront of English football. There were pressing financial demands on them now, owing to the opening at White Hart Lane of the new West Stand. If Tottenham were to maintain their reputation for colour and style, they needed the revenue from a remarkable 7 appearances at Wembley in the space of 15 months. The modern team matched the double side in at least one respect. They won the FA Cup for the second year in a row. The opponents this time, Queen's Park Rangers.
Away from John Gregory, Graham Roberts, Archibald to his right. He overran it, but still got through. This is Graham Roberts. Was he brought down? Penalty. Tony Curry came in behind him. Fenwick was in close attendance, but a penalty has been given, and it was a splendid run by Graham Roberts. Penalty. Hoddle to take. Scores. Never has a penalty been missed in an FA Cup final at Wembley.
More glory for Spurs in their centenary year. And for those who built a glamorous club, a time to reflect.
Well, obviously, insofar as football is concerned, it means almost everything, doesn't it, really? Because I can reflect back to being a player with and manager of some of the finest players that have ever been in the game. And naturally, I'm a Tottenham man, obviously. And so, therefore, the first result I look for in any game, in any Saturday, is Tottenham Hotspur's result.
Looking back over all the years that you've been associated with Spurs, either as player, manager, supporter, what do you think the club really means to you?
I like them. They're a great club. And to be associated with them was nice.
Let's wish them another 100 years of success.